Ramayana Kalpavrksam.
We are very honored, at least I am very personally honored also, to have with us Dr. Sudha Seshayan. Both Tulsidas's Ramcharit Manas and Kamba's Ramayana are known for their highly descriptive passages. Both works describe the meeting of Rama and Sita even before they see each other in the, you know, in the shala where the Dhanurbhanga happens. One is the Pushpavatika Prasang, and here they see themselves very briefly. Now, the Shiva Dhanurbhangam is a grand episode in the Kamba Ramayana. V.S. was a psychologist of sorts. I call him a psychologist because he brings out such subtle emotional nuances in the Dhanurbhangam section when he says, I will just read it first. Manjushalone amarchi konambu konambandu nokki tratam koppu nekku vette kabolu. Manjushika vinirgamanambu velake javalli bigisiyunde. తాళ ప్రమాణమౌ ధనువు జానకి దృష్టి కడ్డముగా వచ్చునని ఎంచు ఎంచే కాబోలు అడ్డంబుగా ధనుస్సును పూని విడి బాకువలే త్రాడు వ్రీలలాడే అతని దృష్టికి జానకి ఆగలేదు అతని కృష్టికి శివధనుస్సాగలేదు సీత పూజడ వెన్నుగా శిరసు వంచే చెరుకుగడవోలె నడిమికి విరిగే ధనువు. Now, just to give you a little brief idea of what this means, he beautifully says that, see, when you put something in a box, you loosen it and you put it there. But when he removed the dhanus from the box, it was already ready and taut to be discharged. But when he held it in front of him, his eye was not able to connect with Sita's. So that's why he bent it horizontally. And then when he saw her and she saw him, she could not control herself when she saw him. So she bent her head in acquiescence. And that is when the willow just broke like a sugarcane bow. Now the resonance of the breaking of the bow is described in Harikatha literature in Telugu with tremendous alliteration. They say, villu virige pellu pelluna. అల్లన రిపులుల్లంబులు ఝల్లన భీతిల్లగ శివు విల్లు విరిగే పెళ్ళు పెళ్ళున. లెట్ అస్ లిసన్ టు డాక్టర్ సుధా శేషయ్యన్ అన్రావెల్ ది సీక్రెట్స్ ఆఫ్ ద కంబ రామాయణ. అ మెడికల్ డాక్టర్, టీచర్, అడ్మినిస్ట్రేటర్ అండ్ ఎడ్యుకేషనిస్ట్, డాక్టర్ సుధా ఇస్ ఆల్సో అ స్పిరిచువల్ స్కాలర్ అండ్ ఒరేటర్, అ తమిళ్ అండ్ సంస్కృత్ లిటరీ రిసోర్స్, అన్ ఆథర్, అ మీడియా పర్సనాలిటీ, ద ఫార్మర్ వైస్ ఛాన్సలర్ ఆఫ్ ద తమిళనాడు డాక్టర్ ఎంజీఆర్ మెడికల్ యూనివర్సిటీ. She has over 3 decades of experience in teaching and knowledge systems. She has the special credit of being the compiling and publishing editor of the Tamil version of the concise Brittanica Encyclopaedia. We welcome Dr. Sudha Seshayan to share her knowledge with us.
Vanakkam, pranams. Let me start with the first verse of Kamba Ramayana, which is my usual prayer. Ulagam yavayum tamula vakkalum nilai peruthalum neekkalum neengala alagila vilaiyattudaiyar avar thalaivar annavarke sharan naangale. I am not a language scholar. I am not an expert in arts. So kindly permit me to go by the discipline of the PowerPoint presentation. I made this so that I am disciplined. Ramayana, or for that matter, any of the Indian itihaasas or kavyas, I would prefer to call them kavyas, itihaasas, than call them by the English name, anglicized epics, have a different approach. Those of you who may be familiar with the approaches of literary criticism would know the Ramayana or any version of Ramayana for that matter, will not be applauded by the standards of Aristotelian poesy. Aristotle says you would have to start an epic close to the climax, something similar to the current day movies. You would have to start the story close to the climax and not go by the chronology. Believe me, Ramayana, for that matter, whichever version of Ramayana, most of the versions of Ramayana start with Ramajananam. And Aristotelian poesy will not agree to this chronological order. The basic difference between the Eastern approach and the Western approach is that, as Ami rightly pointed out, it is not the hero-villain relationship, but the human value approach that is the basis of any of these itihaasas or kavyas. Ravana is not a villain. Ravana is a tragic hero. Ravana is a tragic hero, not a villain at all. And if I may tread a little into the names, Ananda was elaborating on the name Ramayana yesterday. I don't think Valmiki prefers to call it Ramayana. Neither does Kamba nor Tulsi. Tulsi calls it Manasa. Kamba calls it Ramavatar. And Valmiki says it's Paulastya Vadam. And what is Paulastya Vadam? The Vadam of Paulastya. And who was Paulastya? The grandson of Pulastya. Brahma's son was sage Pulastya, one of the Prajapatis. And Pulastya's son was sage Vishrava. And Vishrava's one son was Vaishravana or Kubera. And Vishrava's other sons were Ravana, Kumbhakarna, and Vibhishana. In other words, Ravana is the great-grandson of Brahma. And Valmiki emphatically says, if even the great-grandson of Brahma deviates from the path of Adharma, he would die and perish. And that is what is Paulastya Vadam. Let me take you on a journey into Kamba Ramayana, maybe a very brief journey. This is a paragraph which I have quoted here, a paragraph written by Justice Magarajan. Justice Magarajan was a judge of the Madras High Court sometime in the 1970s. And in his monograph to the Sahitya Academy, he writes thus, quote, "Judging from the fantastic popularity that Kamban enjoys in 20th century Tamil Nadu, a foreigner may be tempted to think that Kamban is a contemporary poet who has sung of the absorbing problems of today. Such a guess would be 11 centuries off the mark." And that is what we are here to think about. The perennial contemporaneity of Ramayana and all versions of Ramayana for that matter. This theme and storyline had been known for ages, ever so in Tamil Nadu. The Sangam literature, the Tamil Sangam literature, which can be dated back 5,000 years from now, has episodes of Ramayana narrated. Maybe shorter ones, longer ones, but then there are references to the Rama story. The major epics like Silapadigaram do have lines which talk about Rama, talk about the Dashavatara. In fact, in one particular line which many of the musicians may be familiar with, because this is a song which had been sung by M.S. Subbalakshmi, there is a reference to the Rama story. The author says, you wanted to walk. You could not complete it in one of your janmas. You know, you wanted to take a long walk. You could not complete it in one of your janmas. Something was left out. And you completed your desire in yet another janma. The reference is, you wanted to walk 3 steps, could not do that in your Vamana avatar. You walked only 2 steps, one was left out, and that was completed in the 14 years you walked as Rama. Moolakum yiradiyal murai naramba vagai mudiya taaviya sevadi seppa thambiyodu kaanpoondu. So that is a kind of a reference that we find in the epics, even Silapadigaram. I quote Silapadigaram because Silapadigaram was written by a Jain monk. And of course, the 12 Aalvars who had given the Rama story in different ways. Some of the innovations we think are from the Kamba Ramayana and from Ranganatha Ramayana are in fact recollections of what the Aalvars have given us. I would like to kind of subclassify this chintana into 3 parts. The modifications in the storyline that Kambar has made. Part 2 will be the kind of modifications in the design, not the storyline, but the design. And of course, part 3, the everlasting message that the poet wants to give in the pretext of Rama's story. Now, this is what Anupama was referring to. There are several minor modifications. We all know that there are several modifications in many of the versions of Ramayana, and I do agree with my good friend Hemant when he says Rama's story is Rama Anubhav and not mere story. And here is the specific situation that Anupama was talking about. Now, in the Sangam literature, there is reference to what is called Kalavurukam and Karpurukam. Putting it briefly, the man and the woman are supposed to meet, decide for themselves that they are fitting partners, and then subsequently proceed further. This is part of Sangam literature. And Kambar wants to bring this into the Ramayana story. So Rama and Sita cannot be part of that already determined Yajnashala situation. They would have to see each other much before. So what does he do? Vishwamitra is leading the 2 boys into the city of Mithila. The 3 of them are walking. And look at this. All these Ramayana Kavyakartas had been great psychologists. Vishwamitra walking in front, followed by Rama, and probably a few steps behind, that dutiful brother, Lakshmana. And as a man, you know, certain things are imbibed. I'm a medical person. And biology cannot be changed. You know, talk about whatever, modernism, feminism, I've never been able to understand the meaning of some of these words at all. And as an anatomist who has been teaching human anatomy for 35 years in my life, I know pretty well there are differences between the man's brain and the woman's brain. Let's accept fact as fact. This is Yadartha. The man walks slightly chin up, right? And the woman looks down like that. This is biology. This cannot be altered. And I am reminded of a statement by Ramanuja, sage Ramanujacharya, where he says, you know, Mova Yirindar, men are referred to as Mova Yirindar because they are chin-up people. They walk like that. So Rama walks like that. Probably his, you know, eyesight, the line of his sight was a little upwards. And Sita is there in the balcony. Janaka's daughter, right? So she is in the balcony, Upparigai, which is probably the first floor or maybe even the second floor or whatever. That's for your imagination. And then she is there standing and she came there to the balcony. Maybe she was playing something or she was with her friends or whatever. She just came and looked like that and the three of them walking. Vishwamitra is a sage, at least, I mean, pardon me, at this particular sequence, he has controlled all his indriya and he is walking. And Rama is naturally looking up like that. And then Kambar goes to say, Annalum nokinan, avalum nokinal. For those people who are Tamilians, either you know Kambaramayanam or not, you will definitely know these two lines. Annalum nokinan, avalum nokinal. And in our college days, we used to have a kind of a corollary to this. Appanum nokinan, adithu norkinan. And that is when the hearts intermingle. He says, ondrai ondru unnavum nilaiperadu annalum nokinan, avalum nokinal. Now the curious part of this scene is that Rama does not know who Sita is. And Sita does not know who Rama is. This is fleeting, momentary, gone he is. She keeps thinking about him and he keeps thinking about her. They do not know each other. He does not know it is this particular girl who will subsequently be, you know, placed as a kind of a condition in the Yajnashala. This is another, I mean, I thought I'll give you the translation of the verse in Kambar. And that is what it is. Engrossed were their eyes, each pair tried to devour the other. He sent forth his glance and she her mighty lance. And this modification subsequently has found its place in several other later versions of Ramayana. And those of you who are Ramayana scholars will agree with me, though we say Adikavi Valmiki, many of the later day Ramayana Kavyakartas have drawn their inspiration not merely from Valmiki, but from Kalidasa. Several things have come from Kalidasa and not from Valmiki. Probably they all thought. Kambar in fact says, Vangarum padam nangum vahutta Valmiki enban. And then follows Valmiki almost, you know, every step. If Valmiki says Rama walked for two yojanas, Kambar dutifully endorses and says, yes, he walked only for two yojanas. Not 1 millimeter more or not 1 millimeter less. Nevertheless, these deviations, which are part of the Kala Desha Vardhamana deviations. Now, this is one which has found its place in Tulsi and, of course, in several of the Southeast Asian Ramayanas. And there is one other deviation in the storyline. There are many more. I'm just picking up one or two examples which would give us an inkling as to what kind of a kavya which Kambar was trying to give us. Now, this is where Guha, as he beholds Bharata coming with a big chainya, is a little pain struck. You all know the situation. Bharata, Shatrughna, the rest of them want to bring Rama back to Ayodhya. All of them go. And then seeing from a distance, Guha is able to see that there are flags there, there are elephants, horses. You know, Bharata's intention was to go with all the four bands of the chainya and then bring back Rama in all grandeur in a grand procession. But looking at this paraphernalia from a distance, Guha is given to think that Bharata is coming in to fight with Rama. And this is what we find in many of the versions. And here is a small twist in the version, a small tweak rather. Guha thinks the same way. And there are about 10 or 12 verses of Kamba Ramayana where Guha, you know, walks this way, that way, hither, thither, and says, you know whom I am. I would do this Bharata's army into pieces. Like, you know, he has told me that I am his brother. Eramai vedan irandilan endranai esaru and all that. But then as the army comes nearer and nearer and nearer, as Guha sees what happens, he's able to see what Bharata is and what Shatrughna is. For those of you who can understand, Varkalayin udayanai masadinda meyyanai narkalayil madiyenna nagayidanda mugathanai. I'll go to the translation. This is the vivid description, the physical description of what Bharata was. Clad in bark, his body dust-laden, face lost in luster, resembled a waning moon. The idea is Bharata was clad in the same bark attire that Rama would be clad. The tiniest of the tiny modifications. In the Valmiki Ramayana, you find Bharata and Shatrughna were there dressed in their regular regal attire. And there is a possibility, an element of suspicion in the minds of Guha and his men. But then here is the physical change where Bharata is clad in the same bark attire. And then Guha, looking at it, now thinks, நம்பியும் என் நாயகனை ஒக்கின்றான் அயல் நின்ற தம்பியை ஒக்கின்றான். Now Guha is on the banks of the Ganges. Just imagine, let's get into that anubhava ourselves. Rama will not mind. We are on the banks of Ganges, the northern banks of Ganges, because from Ayodhya, Bharata and the rest of them are coming. And Guha has just ferried Rama, Sita and Lakshmana to the southern banks of Ganges. And standing at the southern bank of Ganges, Bharata is able to see what's happening on the northern banks. He hurriedly comes to the northern bank. When he reaches the northern bank, the army has come closer. So the distance is decreased and he is able to see Bharata there. And looking at Bharata, he thinks, what's happening here? Two of them here. But then I just left these two people there. I just left the two of them there, the brothers. And these two resemble the same brothers. The only difference is there was a woman there and here is a big army. Bharata was almost like Rama and Shatrughna almost like Lakshmana. For a few seconds, Guha gets confused. But then that is the place where Bharata's character gets completely effaced. Completely effaced. You now anticipate what kind of Bharata would you see in the rest of the Kavya. Those outpourings of the Ramayana by Right Honorable V.S. Srinivasa Sastri, wherein Srinivasa Sastri says, see this Bharata. And that is the Bharata which Kambar gives us, and that's a translation of the other, the second verse. So these are the modifications in the storyline. As the storyline progresses, smaller modifications. And let's go to the style now. What are the modifications that we find in the style? Now, this is one important area. I'm just making this reference because many of us feel Rama's story is an anubhava, and it is the national anubhava. It is not the mere analysis of the story, it is not the mere episodes in the story that matter, but then the kind of involvement, the kind of shraddha, the kind of faith, the kind of belief that each one of us have. Now there is something called Lakshman Rekha. The Indian populace believes in Lakshman Rekha. Though Valmiki, Kambar or Tulsi did not mention a Lakshman Rekha. the Indian populace believes. In a personal conversation which I had with Dr. Pandaranga Rao, who was the national president of the Sahitya Academy in the 1980s, Dr. Rao told me, it took me 27 years, Sudha, to believe that there is no academic Lakshman Rekha in any of the three major Ramayanas of the country. And the belief of Lakshman Rekha has percolated into our brains, neuronal circuitry so much that the anti-cockroach repellent is named Lakshman Rekha. Marketing strategy, people know, we believe in Lakshman Rekha, right? Here is the version of Sita's abduction by Ravana. You know, in the Uttarakanda of Valmiki, there is one statement which says, Rama's head will break into pieces if he touches a woman who does, Ravana's head, I'm sorry, who does not like Ravana. And there are many versions. This is supposed to be Vedavati's curse. This is supposed to be Nalakubara's curse and so on. Now, here is Kambar's innovation. So, Ravana cannot carry Sita like that. Ravana's head might break and we lose the story there. The Kavya will not proceed. So, Kambar innovates. He kind of says, after the conversation that they have, and after that, like Sita realizes it is Ravana who is standing there, Ravana steps back. And then what does he do? And aayidai, tiyavan aayidaiyai thindan. He will not touch her. Ayanmel urai sindai seyya. He thinks of that curse which is on him. Thundan yenalam uyarthol valiyal kundan nilam. With his hill-like shoulders, with all that bhuja parakrama, he would kind of dig the earth and carry the parnashala along with that earth, lift it and place it on the Pushpak Viman. And then when he goes and places it in the Ashokavana, it is the same parnashala and same piece of earth on which she is sitting. Now, this is a modification in Kambar, of course, you all know. You all know that there is a modification in Tulsi where, you know, this question prevails. Ravana did not abduct Sita at all. It was only Maya Sita. And of course, this is a version which is found in the Devi Bhagavata. This is a version found in the Adhyatma Ramayana and so on. Now, this is a change in the design. And there is a change in the design. One other change in the design, there was a lot of discussion about Vali and Tara and all that here. This is a change in the design where Kambar portrays a Tara. I'll just narrate briefly what happens there. You know, Vali is killed and then Rama is in the forest waiting for the rainy days to come to an end. And then he has already informed Sugriva to come back. But then Sugriva is so blissfully, joyfully engrossed in his regal comforts that he does not come to meet Rama. And then Rama dispatches Lakshmana to go meet Sugriva and tell him, I have the same arrow that pierced Vali with me. And then when Lakshmana goes, by then Sugriva realizes his fallacy and finds a way. He sends Tara to meet Lakshmana. Tara does not even talk. She just comes. Lakshmana looks at her, beholds her, looks at what Tara is. And believe me, Lakshmana, who had forgotten his own mother for the last so many years, now gets reminded of his mother. Because Tara is a widow. Her attire is the attire of a widow, completely covering herself until the neck. This is a marked deviation, a deviation in the style. No longer Kambar is prepared to accept Tara to be taken into the palace of Sugriva. You know the reason what Ami said here. What was the reason given by Rama to Vali to have killed Vali or to have attempted to kill Vali? You took away your brother's wife. And how can now Sugriva make the same mistake? If taking Sugriva's wife was a mistake committed by Vali, how can Sugriva take Vali's wife after the death of Vali? Probably this was a question which was lingering in the minds of Kamba. And so he kind of modifies the design and Tara becomes a widow there. And Lakshmana gets reminded of his own mother's things. My mother would be like this after the death of Dasharatha. And then the vision, I would briefly run through. Now, this is a sequence which we find when the Rajamatas are being ferried across Ganges. I'm going back and forth in the storyline. Now, this is a very important sequence. All of them who have come from Ayodhya have been transported to the southern banks of Ganges to reach Chitrakuta where Rama is. And then in the last boat, Bharata, Shatrughna and the three Rajamatas. Mind you, Kaikeyi is also there. And Guha, who has already met with Bharata the previous evening, wants to know, he can understand these are the three Rajamatas, but then wants to know who exactly is whom. So he is requesting Bharata to introduce the three ladies and then Bharata dutifully does it. Let me skip how he introduces Kaikeyi, how he introduces Sumitra, but then he says, this is Kausalya, the mother of Rama. At which Guha falls at the feet of Kausalya and starts crying. He could not control himself. The Anubhava, he could not control himself and he starts crying. And looking at Guha crying, Bharata cries, Shatrughna cries. Now there are six people in the boat, three men, three women. Pardon me, I'm not gender discriminative here. But then the three men are crying. What's happening to the three women? Sumitra is a jnani, she does not cry. Kaikeyi, of course, you know, Stita Prajna, she is standing there, not crying. And Kausalya, what do you expect from an average mother like Kausalya? My son has come to the forest. And all fate, destiny. No, she does not cry. She smiles, picks up Guha, and then says, don't worry, my sons. It is primarily because Rama came to the forest that we've been able to get a relative like this. We've been able to get a relative like this primarily because Rama was sent to the forest. And then I'll tell you one thing. My dear sons, when Rama comes back, all five of you join together and rule the kingdom. All five of you join together. Naivir, Alir, Maindir. All the five get united and rule this land of ours for some decades to come, she blessed. What else is positivity? What else is dharma? What else is value? It is not the fight between a hero and a villain, but then it is sustenance of dharma. And this is another sequence, again, going, you know, anterior words, much before in the story. This is the situation when Rama is about to be crowned. Tomorrow is the Pattabhishekam. And this evening, Dasharatha would request sage Vasishta to give an upadesha to Rama because he's going to be the king from tomorrow. And then Vasishta dutifully does it and says, Rama, please remember, don't have enmity or hostility with anyone. This is the upadesha to someone who's becoming the king. And Vasishta says, don't have any war. Don't have any yuddha. Yar odum pahai kollalan yenil por odungum. You will not have wars at all. Don't have enmity at all. You be at peace with everyone. Friends, we've always learned in our history textbooks that someone becomes a greater king or an emperor when he annexes more and more and more of land. You know, a king becomes, it was Philip, Prince Philip of Macedonia, but then how did Alexander become Alexander the Great? Just by annexing more and more of territory. But here is an Upadesha which comes. Tomorrow you will be a king, but do not attempt to annex territories. It is not in annexing territories, it is not in fighting with someone that you become a great king, but in the sustenance of dharma that you become a great king. Now this is the coronation verse, the Pattabhishega verse. Customary to conclude anything on Ramayana with the coronation, right? So this is the Pattabhishekam verse. For those of you who can understand Tamil, or even those of you who can understand Telugu, Kannada, you will know a little of it. All these are Bharatiya languages. I'll just read it. Ariyanai Anumanthanga, Angadan Udaival Yenda, Bharatan Venkudai Kavika, Iruvarum Kavari Patra, Viraisari Kudali Wonga, Venayur Sadayan, Marabulor, Koduppa Vangi, Vasitane, Punaindan, Mauli. You have the mention of Anuman. You have the mention of Angada. Bharata, Iruvarum Kavari Patra, you know, the two brothers who are, you know, giving you breeze with the chamara on either side. Viraisari Kudali, the one with, you know, fragrant tresses. I cannot find the name of Sita there. I can only presume it's Sita. Viraisari Kudali Wonga, Vennayur Sadayan Marabulor, that's the paradox. Sadayappa Vallal is supposed to be the philanthropist who supported Kambar. And then he says, this, the forefather of Sadayappa Vallal would have been there at the time of coronation. And that forefather had lifted the crown and had given it to Vasishta. And then Vasishta kept it on Rama's head. Fine. Kambar had the forethought to bring in the forefather of Vennayur Sadayappan, but did not have the thinking process to bring the name of Rama there. Now please check, where is the name of Rama there? Ariyanai Anumanthanga, Angadan Udaival Yenda, Bharatan Venkudai Kavika, Iruvarum Kavari Patra, Viraisari Kudali Wonga, Vennayur Sadayan Marabulor Koduppa Vangi, Vasitane Punaindan Mauli. Yaarukupa? You write a wedding invitation, you print a wedding invitation, you send a wedding invitation without the name of the groom. There is no name of the groom here. That is why Kambar is very, very careful. He does not even say it is Sita. You know, if he had said Sita, it goes without saying it is Rama. So he has deliberately avoided the names of Rama and Sita, only to indicate it was not the coronation of one prince by name Rama, who was a descendant of the Ikshvaku clan. It was not the coronation of one prince who lived ages ago. All that analysis, what was the time of Rama and when did Ramayana happen, all that. Here is the answer. It is the coronation of Dharma. It was not Rama's coronation, it was Dharma's coronation. And that is Kamba Ramayanam, which remains a treasure for all times. Kamban can never become out of date because he speaks to us and to the whole world with a voice, not of yesterday. It is the story of yesterday, we all think. But then Hemanji told us it is the Anubhava of today. But here comes the voice of tomorrow. Thank you very much.